In 2023, the Sunshine Coast saw rising inflation and interest rates while real estate prices moderated. I'll start the new year by reviewing what happened over the past 12 months and make some predictions for 2024. Between January 2023 and December 2023, the price for a detached home on the Sunshine Coast dropped by 1.5%. Townhouse prices dropped by 5% and apartment-style condos were down 7%. There's still demand for Sunshine Coast real estate, but headed into 2024, buyers and sellers have different price expectations for this market.
I think inflation and interest rate increases were the big story for 2023, weren't they, Tony?
I agree, yeah.
Canadians saw three rate increases in 2023, but that's in addition to four rate increases in 2022. So the rate increases really start to pile up towards the end of 2023. Inflation did slow, but it's not back to pre-pandemic levels, and it's still higher than the federal government would like to see. So while we were better off this year than we were last year, and even at the start of the year, things are not where anybody wants them to be. How did those two factors impact the housing market on the Sunshine Coast in 2023?
With the interest rate increases, it reduced people's borrowing capacity. And we found that there were a lot of people that were shopping, in a certain price range, all of a sudden found that they couldn't qualify for that anymore. And so I think it reduced the size of the buyer pool that could afford or qualify for the higher end properties. And so we've noticed that what was a very busy segment, being between 1 million and 1.5 million, has slowed down considerably. And now the busy spots is between, 700 and 900,000. They're the properties that are getting most of the attention at the moment.
The other big change in 2023 was to short-term rentals, specifically here in BC. The provincial government has essentially outlawed short-term rentals, except for a very narrow set of exclusions. And what did that news do to the market at the end of 2023?
What we noticed is I got a lot of calls from buyers that had purchased, short-term rentals, and they're were operating them, using them on the weekends when they wanted to, and then, and then renting them out when they weren't there. The Sunshine Coast is kind of within 4 hours door-to-door, including the ferry time, so it's kind of in that sweet spot. And the provincial mandate to eliminate the majority of short-term rentals has resulted in those buyers, not existing anymore because it's not something that they can do. Mm-hmm. And the people that are in the position where they're renting out a cabin and using it themselves on weekends and that kind of thing, and relying upon the short-term rental revenue to, service that mortgage and maintain that property, are basically going to be forced to sell.
So a lot of doom and gloom on the Sunshine Coast last year in the real estate market and provincially and federally as well. But on a personal level, every year there's some interesting real estate stories that we come across. And this year, I think there was a real doozy, wasn't there?
Yeah, it's my best story. So if you want my best story, I'll give it to you. So I'm sitting in my office and I get a phone call, and it's a nice chap. He rings me up. He tells me he's got a semi-waterfront type home and he wants to sell it. And we get chatting about, what he's doing and why he wants to sell and what his situation is. And about 10 minutes in the conversation, I eventually say, well, do you have to buy somewhere before, do you have to sell to buy somewhere? And he goes, no, I've bought a ranch already up in Kamloops and I want to get rid of the house. And I said, oh, what made you buy a ranch up there? And he said, oh, well, I really like fireworks. And at that point, I'm like, oh, God, I thought, he's just some schmuck that has been wasting my time because occasionally, I get the old funny phone call.
Because the background on that is in April, we had done an April Fool's video.
That's right.
Where Tony had promised that every sale he got, he would do some massive fireworks show. And there was two groups of people. There were people that got the joke and there's people that were unhappy that you were going to do dozens and dozens of fireworks shows every year.
Absolutely.
So your initial thought when this guy calls and says, oh, I really like fireworks, is that he's pulling your leg, I guess.
Pulling my leg, yeah. Like it was, it was a few months after the April video, I think in July. And yeah, so I assumed that it was a waste of time. So I'm a little bit, angry with him and I'm like, good one, whatever, go to hang up. And he's like, well, what are you talking about? And he playing dumb that he had no idea about this video. So fortunately, with it being a small town, his house is on the way to my house of driving home. So I stopped in at his place on the way just to kind of validate if he's legit or what the deal is. So when I get to his house, he turns out he's a really nice guy. He used to be an ambulance technician in Vancouver. He ended up retiring, and part of his retirement, he got into fireworks. And so he was legitimately fully into fireworks. And so I you know, ended up showing him the video, and he thought that was great, and it helped kind of, you know, close the listing kind of for me. And we did a deal. I said, if I sell your house for over what you want, will you put on a fireworks show? And he goes, I'd love to. So I ended up selling his house more than what he wanted. We did up, you know, we kind of agreed that we'd do a fireworks show at some point. And then it all came together in October, which you were at, and we got some footage of.
Yeah, it was great. It turned out really good. I love the story because I think it's astronomical, the odds of somebody that's legitimately into fireworks calling a realtor that did a fireworks prank and both not knowing what's going on.
Like exactly,
that is crazy. And then to go and see in, it was on Halloween, right?
The Halloween, fireworks, yeah.
That we went to see this fireworks show, and we're both from bigger centers, and we've seen a fair amount of fireworks shows in our days, but this was bananas. This rivaled anything I'd seen in a big city.
Yeah, the only downside for me and for the people that came is I think it absolutely ruined fireworks for them for the rest of their life, because it was so intimate, so close, such a high level. It was like 25 minutes nonstop. Yep. Well choreographed, you know, I mean, it was crazy. And yeah, like I say, it ruined fireworks for me.
Yeah, me too.
But what an awesome experience. And yeah, such a good story, because it's so, you know, it's such a long odds for that to ever
exactly
happen, you know?
If we look back on 2023 and we see it as inflation, interest rates, Airbnbs, and fireworks, we have to look forward and see how those things are going to carry over into 2024. Maybe not the fireworks, but yeah, everything else.
Quit fireworks.
So in 2024, what do you predict happens with interest rates?
Well, like you said, I think what the inflation rate nationally, I think, still 3.1%. I think in BC it was like 2.9%, but I think they want it between 2 and 3 nationally, closer to 2 than 3. I see that there's quite a bit of pressure. Seems to be a lot of pressure, even though it's meant to be, you know, like what do you call it, standalone and not to be able to be influenced.
Right.
There seems to be a lot of pressure on the, you know, Bank of Canada to drop interest rates. So I wouldn't be surprised if we saw a quarter point drop in February or March. I'd say that could be likely, and that may rally you know, the real estate market at that point a little bit. Long term, I think that the interest rates that we're at now are basically the new normal. And they are more normal, I think, than free money.
That's right.
So, you know, I mean, I think that's probably, hopefully we're going to stay around this, you know, 5.5%. Maybe it'll drop a little bit in February or March, but I think that'll be the only reduction we see. And then, you know, we'll see what happens from there, you know.
So with uncertainty around interest rates and maybe a recession or maybe not, should Sunshine Coasters list now or wait to sell later in the year?
I think it really depends on their situation. In general, I'd say you're better off, you know, if you need to sell, if you list the property at an appropriate price point, there are buyers for it. So if you know, as long as you're not trying to sell it for 40% above assessed value or something like that, if you price it appropriately and you know, you do need to sell, then list now. If you're speculating, you know, now's not the time really to list. And, you know, if you're someone that owns a Airbnb and you know in June that you're not going to be able to get the revenue anymore, then you need to get that up and get that listed. You want to be ahead of the curve on that one. So I think really it depends on, you know, someone's situation. If you don't have to sell, then now isn't the time to list. If you have to sell, then you should price it appropriately and list it now, yeah.
If you're sitting on an Airbnb and you know you're going to have to sell by late spring, early summer, what are the benefits of listing early versus the risks of waiting till the end to list?
Well, if you list now, you've got less competition out there. There's less, you know, less similar listings out there. And, you know, you've got more, a bigger pool of buyers that potentially are going to be looking at your property. If you wait till the end when everybody else is listing, then, you know, the surplus inventory is going to have a softening effect on the prices, and so you're probably going to be looking at selling it for less than you would if you did now. The downside to selling now is you've got 6 months worth of revenue that you could capture, and then not that I'm condoning this in any way, but a lot of people are asking, you know, like, or talking about how they're going to enforce this. Are they going to have teeth? I mean, it's a blanket thing across the whole of BC. There's however many hundreds of thousands of Airbnbs out there. I mean, how well organized are they going to be at handling this? Is it going to go down to each municipality to take care of it? Is Seashelt going to be able to you know, keep track of it and enforce bylaws and that kind of stuff? Is it going to be you know, if someone has an existing clientele of guests that have stayed there before and they take their listing down off off of Airbnb and they're just running it privately, is there going to be a way for the local municipalities to know that that's going on, or will that just be driven by complaints of neighbours, you know, all that kind of thing? So, I mean, that could be a risk of selling early, is you might sell early, take a loss, and then turns out that, you know, this isn't going to be enforced, or there's been an extension granted or whatever it is for another year, right? So there's so many unknowns at this point but if you are underwater and you know you're going to have to sell, in general, you're better off doing it sooner rather than later.
We're going to do something a little bit different this year than we've done in years past for end of the year. I'm going to throw lightning round questions at you, which are predictions for the next year.
Mm-hmm.
And you just tell me what you think is going to happen. Which film wins best Oscar this year?
Top Gun Maverick. Mm-hmm.
Who wins, in my heart, anyway. Who wins the Stanley Cup this year?
Oh, Canucks are looking good for that.
Will Taylor Swift and Travis Kelce get engaged this year?
No, they'll split up pretty soon.
Well, pretty soon?
Yeah.
Wow, okay, there you go.
This year, anyway, this coming year, yeah.
Okay. By December of 2024, the price of Bitcoin will be?
I'm not sure what it's at now. What's it at now?
I think like 55,000 or something Canadian.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So it's still, so.
It's had a rally here the last little bit.
Let's say 35,000.
Oh, it's going to go down. Okay. Does Twitter make it to the end of 2024 or does it implode?
You're talking X?
X, yeah.
I don't know, man. If he keeps selling his advertisers to F off, then I'd say it doesn't make it to the end.
Finish the sentence. This year's Paris Olympics will be?
In France.
Molly's Reach will reopen in Gibsons in which month?
I would predict, should it reopen, it'll probably be in May. May 2-4 weekend will be the weekend.
Seashell will run out of water in which month?
let's go with June.
June. Oh, early. I'd have thought later, maybe August, but okay, June. I guess we haven't got a whole lot of rain yet this year.
It's still technically in a drought.
Will there be any boathouses left in Pender Harbor by the end of the year?
I think there will be some left, but a lot of them, I think, will be gone based on what's going on now.
Combined number of times that Sunshine Coasters will curse the existence of BC Ferries in 2024.
Combined?
Combined.
Got to be in the tens of millions, I'd say. No, let's say, say the low hundreds of thousands, so 300,000 times, I'd say.
Tony, what do you have on the market to kick off 2024?
We have a lovely 5-acre hobby farm on Byng Road that we had listed earlier in the year, and the circumstances of the sellers changed, but now they've changed back again and they're interested in selling. So that's, got an orchard on it. The owner prior to these guys lived there for like 30 years, something like that. And there's so many nice little cute customized area on in that area. They've got like a bunch of glamping sites set up at the back. The gentleman that owns it, he's a craftsman. So he's done a lot of renovations and stuff inside. It's a really, really nice, kind of the ideal kind of hobby farm that people from the city, when they think, I want to move to the country and have some acreage, it's kind of perfect for that. In addition to that, we've got the Burns Road property. We've taken that off temporarily just to try to figure out how the higher density zoning is going to affect it. That one, it's got a creek running through it. And so with the riparian setback requirements and that type of stuff, it was kind of limited as to what could be built on there. Mm-hmm. But, with zoning changes that allow higher density, it might make a lot more sense for a developer to pick it up because they could put, more doors on it. I'm interested to see how that one pans out, but that's a really good opportunity. And lastly, we still have the lot on Skyline. Getting a lot of interest on that one. It is a little bit of a challenging build just with the grade of the property, but I'm sure that one, be a perfect fit for someone that's looking for waterfront and, at a price that they can afford.
That Skyline lot, that is something that if anybody is even casually interested in a waterfront lot in Gibsons, that's when you'll look back on 2 or 3 years and swear that it slipped through your fingers, because I think that's a really good buy there.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's like less than half a tax assessment at the moment. And really, it's just because it needs someone to figure out an easier way to build on it. But yeah, they'd be my three picks for 2024.
Thanks for watching, and if you haven't already, please consider subscribing. While you're here, maybe you want to check out one of my listings or watch my video about why you should choose me to sell your home.